Once again, Sheila Dixit, who's the Chief Minister of New Delhi, the capital. Mr. Dixit, maybe ask you a specific question which may reflect some of the concerns that have been expressed over these couple of days. I think many people in the room would imagine that the infrastructure that was laid down in Delhi for the Asian Games about 20 years ago was part of the problem that Delhi faces now in terms of flyovers, which is basically meant for motorized transport. In the planning for the future Commonwealth Games, we hear that some disquieting developments, for instance, a large-scale redevelopment of the bank of the Yamuna, in which there is even a mall being planned to recover some of the costs of a metro station. This makes us think of what the former and present Chief Minister Mayawati did on the banks of the Yamuna opposite the Taj Mahal, which made some of us refer to it as Taj Mall. I'm just wondering how you would reflect on how those kinds of urban developments in Delhi are sustainable.
I don't think you need to press the button. Press it back. Yes, thank you. Should be back.
Anyway.
It should be on.
Okay,
be
good. On. Got it? I don't think I can agree with the fact and your conclusion that the 1982 Games did not help Delhi. They took place way back more than 20 years ago. And I think whatever was added on to Delhi at that point of time remained not just for the Games, but became a legacy which made Delhi develop and grow. So I don't think anybody who lives in Delhi or is really familiar with Delhi looks at the Asian Games having been a step which was not in the right direction or that it was something that was regrettable. The Commonwealth Games which are coming up are also looked upon as an opportunity for Delhi's faster growth. Growth has to be there. A population which requires, as I said this morning, of additional 5 million people coming in every year. And space in Delhi being very limited because Delhi, unlike Bombay, Calcutta, and other big cities, does not have a hinterland. It's a state, therefore it's confined. Not only does it have people coming there, it also has people coming daily about another million people coming in daily to work there from the outskirts and going back. Now, a city which is growing so fast has to take care of everything. And I underline everything, which includes many who have expressed concerns about inclusive growth, that people who are poor do not get the kind of place they ought to get. But I can tell you that the poor come to Delhi or to other large cities primarily because of economic compulsions. I don't think anybody likes to leave their hometown or their home village just to go out somewhere else unless they feel they're going to be a great economic gain. Nobody likes to break those ties. Having come there, where we have failed, where our planning has failed miserably, is to be able to provide them dignified, decent living spaces. So what they then do is they squat or they buy little bits of land from the land mafia people who capture land. And I must admit to you, and I'm sure those of us who are sitting here who are in the business of governance know that government is complicated. Governance is even more complicated. And we have a bureaucracy which I'm afraid, and I do not mean disrespect to anybody, we have a bureaucracy which does not change as fast as it ought to meet the circumstances that keep changing all the time. I'd also like to say that the systems that we have evolved since the time of the British Raj, those systems have also not changed. And nobody dared change them. That feeling of mistrust of the common man with the government that he or she has to deal with is all pervasive. The bureaucrat feels this man has come here to bother me. The poor person who goes to seek information or get even a small certificate, he feels that this man who's sitting across the table will never do anything unless I give him something under the table. So there is this mistrust. Neither one trusts the other. The saving grace to my mind in that is the democratic process that we have in India. At least, like my friend from Bogota, we have to go back to the people every 5 years and get a vote back. There may be a section of people who may be unhappy with us, there may be a section of people who may be not happy with us, but we have to get elected. We are accountable to that extent. I can't sit there for 30 years and say, all right, I've got my job for 30 years, this is the kind of rungs of the ladder that I'm going to climb, and I can sit satisfied. So I think the governance has also to be administrative governance. We spend money, the JNURM is there, the rural employment scheme is there, and many, many other schemes have come, the Indira Awas Yojana, so on and so on and so forth. But it does not reach the person right below. And that is where I think we have to see where is it and what do we need to do about this. You asked a very pertinent question about the river Yamuna and how that buildings are coming up there, especially you mentioned the Games Village coming up there. It's not coming up overnight. It wasn't a decision, it isn't a decision which was taken just a year and a half ago. This decision to build the village on the banks of the river by clearing up a lot of the slum dwellers that were there in their thousands and lakhs who were given alternative accommodation far away, no doubt, but alternative accommodation nonetheless. They were removed from there. And the village was clear. The building of the village was cleared after clearances were obtained by all the bodies that are relevant. It could be the Water Commission, it could be the environmentalists, it could be those who look at soil structure, those who look at the riverbed and so on and so forth, the underground water, what is going to happen to that underground water if you were to put a building on top of that. But more importantly, there was a huge, huge, huge temple. I think the largest we have, certainly in Delhi, if not one of the largest in northern India. The Akshardham temple, which was built just next to it. I have a question to ask. Why didn't anybody raise a question then? Why didn't anybody raise a doubt? Why has that Akshardham temple been built on the bank of that river? And I can share with you saying that the clearances that were given to the Akshardham temple were exactly the clearances that have been given to the Games Village. Thirdly, I would like to know that you have a city which is growing phenomenally. It has this 10,000 hectares of land, which is supposed to be the riverbed, the banks of the river. Now, the banks of the river have changed, the water quality has changed, the water has come down. Now, whether that 10,000 hectares remains exactly the same as it was 20 years ago when this was decided, that this is the so-called sensitive riverbed banks. Now, can a city like Delhi afford to let alone in the heart of the city 10,000 hectares, nothing happening on it. I would be the happiest person, and I'm sure so would all the governments that are involved with the development of Delhi would be the happiest people to. If people could come around, architects, designers, ecologists, environmentalists, whoever they are, would come around and say, all right, on the banks of this river, this is the kind of greening you should do, this is the kind of spaces you must have, this is the walkways you must have, this is the walkways you must have, these are the only kind of buildings that you must have, the green buildings or whatever, that would be a solution. And believe you me, for 2 years I've been looking for this solution. Anybody and everybody who comes to tell me about this, I said, look, I want an answer. What am I to do? Would you like those squatters to come back here? And also, we have made provision of building, and I promise you we will do it, by the next year, September, October next year, at least 50,000 dwellings for those people who today live in slums, who build a shack. And why did we do this? JNURM, the funds came to us. The house that a poor man is going to buy is probably going to cost about 200,000. Of that 200,000, that 100,000 is going to be a grant from this JNURM fund. 39,000 rupees is the money that is given as a grant of that landowning agency from where these squatters are evicted. For evicting them because they've been sitting there, they have given 39,000 rupees. The government of Delhi gives about 7,000. I hope we'll make it 10,000 because 7,000 is small. The rest of the money we have tied up with banks. They can pay over a period of 15 years, 20 years, 25 years. And the house will belong to them afterwards. And we've also made it mandatory that that house is going to have the dual ownership of your wife, or if a mother or a daughter, name of a woman has to be there. Now, we've done that, and we hope that these people will shift at the end of the next 3 or 4 years. God willing, if things go the way they are right now, we should be able to bring about 4 lakh dwellings like this. I wish I had brought some pictures of them. They're tiny little dwellings, very nice, 4-storied. Water, power, assured water, power supply, a little community center, a school, may not be a high school, but certainly a primary children's school, a small shopping area where you can buy their daily needs, and every little square block has a little garden in front of it, play field in front of it. Now, at the end of it all, the person owns the house. Why did we take this step? Even today, if a person migrates to Delhi, he pays a rent amount of about 1,200 to 800 rupees a month to be able to live in what we call a jhuggi. So instead of paying rent over 20 years, 15 years, or 25 years, depending on his or her choice, if they can spend that money to the bank, give it, and become owners of that place, I think it would be a far wiser step for that family to have taken. Now, I've said this example to you that, and your topic here is, how do you govern cities like this? They're difficult, they're tough. There's a multiplicity, a plethora of authorities. And when you have a city where the federal government also sits there, things are not easy. You also have a city where anything that takes place in India has to happen in Delhi. If it's a film festival, it has to be in Delhi. If it's a games, it has to be in Delhi. If it's a conference of cardiac surgeons, it has to be in Delhi. So I think circumstantially, every city has to grow its way. Every city has to find its own path. But I would certainly underline the fact that whichever city it may be, Bombay, Calcutta, Delhi, Madras, Bangalore, anybody, it has to have an inclusive growth. Otherwise, it's not a city worth being called a city. Thank you very much.
If I understood your figures correctly, you just said that for the Commonwealth Games, you're going to build by this time next year 50,000 homes.
Yes.
If you'd heard the Minister for London yesterday...
More than that.
The Minister for London yesterday and the Minister for the Olympics in London has chosen a site which is 6 kilometres long and 3 kilometres wide, and the number of people being relocated are 3 residents. So it was very shrewd, but well, many more
were
working there. But it's interesting.
You're lucky.
So political... Now, in terms of this key...
London has broken out of its confines. I can't, because Haryana won't let me, UP won't let me.
Different places, but you have to be politically shrewd as you are to find...